Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah al-Aliyy al-Azim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa sallallahu ala Sayyidina wa Nabiyyina Abil Qasim al-Mustafa Muhammad. Wa alihi al-Tayyibin al-Tahirin. La siyama baqiyatillahi fil aradin. Ajjalallahu ta'ala farajahu al-Sharif. Allahumma akhrijni min dhulumat al-wahm wa akrimni min nur al-fahm. اللهم افتح علينا ابواب رحمتك وانشر علينا خزائن علومك رحمتك يا ارحم الراحمين. We continue our discussion with the hadith from tafsir al-mansub ila al-imam al-askari, and we have already had hadith from rasulullah amir al-mu'minin lady fatima alayhim assalam. So the next is from imam hasan. وقال الحسن بن علي عليهما السلام فضل كافل يتيم آل محمد المنقطع عن مواليه الناشب في تيه الجهل يخرجه من جهله ويوضح له ما اشتبه عليه على فضل كافل يتيم يطعمه ويسقيه كفضل الشمس على السهم. The position of someone who looks after orphans is very high, giving them food, medicine, clothes, education, health. It's very important, very, very important. And because it's very, very important, we can use it also as a basis, as a standard to mention other things, rewards. So this hadith says, the one who is kafir, who does kifala, who looks after, takes care of orphan, an orphan of Ahlul Bayt. And the first is the one who is orphan in the sense of, he has no access to his imam. Al-Munqati'i an Mawali, he has been disconnected from his masters. Imam alayhi salam, Imam al-Hujja, is in Ghaiba. Previous Imams have been martyred. And although they are alive, but we don't have connection to Ghaib. So he is in this situation of need. So the merit of someone who looks after an orphan of Ahlul Bayt, who is disconnected from his masters, who is who has first, for example, grown up, who has been living in the condition of difficulties of ignorance. Ti can mean ignorance, darkness, sometimes means takabbur. For example, we have had this tihul fuqara. So someone who is in a situation of ignorance and lack of guidance, because imam is not there to ask him, he needs someone not to give him food necessarily or money necessarily, needs someone to give him guidance. يُخْرِجُهُ مِنْ جَهْلِهِ, he takes him out of his darkness and clarifies for him what has been confusing. So the privilege of someone who looks after such orphans compared to someone who looks after an orphan by feeding him and giving him water is like the privilege of son over a little light in the sky. Like, for example, if there is a clouded moon or clouded, you know, a sky, something like this. I don't remember exactly the meaning of soha, but I think it's a sky which is clouded. Inshallah, we can check and see what is the... Yeah, so maybe if someone can check in the dictionary and let me know, inshallah. So, this is the first hadith, and this is from Imam Hasan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam. The next hadith is from Imam Hussein alayhi salam, so it comes in the same order.
Shall not for the meaning of Suha according to the dictionary.
Yeah.
It is basically ismu kawkab al-ba'id jiddan jiddan.
Aha.
وتصعب رؤيته وهو بعكس القمر القريب والواضح.
Ahsanto. So a star which is very far, so little light comes from that star and compare it to the light of Shams, which is sun. So even it's less than moon, let alone Shams. So the example of someone who looks after orphans of Ahlul Bayt, who are disconnected from their masters, and he clarifies for them what he's been confused with, takes him out of ignorance, compared to the one who looks after the orphans and gives them food and money and, you know, this type of thing, is like the merit of sun over this star, which is very far, therefore it looks very small and has little light. Thank you very much. وقال الحسين بن علي عليه السلام. Imam Hussein عليه السلام also said, من كفل لنا يتيما قطعته عنه أن محنتنا باستتارنا. Very beautiful. The one who looks after an orphan of us, or the one who looks after for our sake an orphan. Lana yatiman means either this is an orphan for us, or he does this for our sake. He looks after an orphan for our sake, or he looks after an orphan of us, that our situation, our difficult situation, our mihna, our difficult situation, our, you know, sad situation, has disconnected him from us, bistitarna, because we are hidden, we are not accessible. Of course, Imam Hussein alayhi salam was not in the ghaiba in the sense that we technically use, but all imams were somehow under restriction and under control, and people were not able to have, you know, always access to them, especially those who were far. And particularly the time of Ghaiba, which would be greatest part of the history of the Shia. So even if Imam Hussein is talking, is not necessarily only talking about his own time, because he's talking about the time of Ahlul Bayt. And most of the time of Ahlul Bayt is in the time of Ghaiba. So, istitarna. Istitar means to be hidden, to be concealed. So someone who has no connection with us because of our situation, that we are not accessible, then another person comes and looks after such orphan. فَوَاسَاهُ مِنْ عُلُومِنَا أَلَّتِي سَقَطَتْ إِلَيْهِ. Then he shares with him, he does muwasat, he shares with him those things that are from our teachings and have reached him, have come to him. So those things that he has received from our teachings, from our knowledge, he shares with such orphans. حَتَّى أَرْشَدَهُ بِهُدَاهُ. Till he guides him with his own guidance that he has received. قَالَ لَهُ اللَّهُ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah the Almighty, would tell him, يَا أَيُّهَا الْعَبْدُ الْكَرِيمُ الْمُوَاسِي. O servant of mine, who is generous, who is muwasi. Muwasi means to do muwasat, means to share with someone what you have and what you yourself also may need. Muwasat. Of course, higher than muwasat is ithar, when you give to the other person and prefer him to yourself, prefer his needs to your needs. That's ithar. But before ithar, muwasat. And with respect to knowledge, maybe it's muwasat because you are not giving out, you are sharing. So it's not that, you know, you deny knowledge to yourself and give it to others. For water, you do this. But one beauty of knowledge is that when you share, you are not denying it to yourself. You don't deprive yourself. فواساه من علومنا التي سقطت إليه حتى أرشده بهداه قال له الله عز وجل يا أيها العبد الكريم المواسي O servant of mine who is generous and who shares إني أولى بهذا الكرم I am more entitled to be generous. Means you have been kareem, I should be more kareem, more generous. So with your limitations, you have been so generous. Now with my capacity, I should be more generous with you. So when you are generous with people, Allah would not show the same generosity to you. Allah says, your generosity has cost you 10% of what you have, 20%, 30%. Then based on that, he would show generosity to you. So how much struggle you have put, how much you have had to, you know, give out, then he would consider that. Not just the only thing that he considers is the amount that you gave. So Allah says, أني أولى بهذا الكرم. I am expected to be more generous than this generosity that you have shown. اجعلوا له يا ملائكتي في الجنان بعدد كل حرف علمه ألف ألف قصر. O my angels, make for him in heaven for every letter that he has taught 1,000,000 palace. Again, I repeat what I have said several times. This is the limit of the language. When we want to refer to the blessings of heaven using worldly terms like house, like food, like fruits, like water, then the measures would not match. What Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives as reward, if you want to divide it into the value of something in dunya like palace, and you just increase the number of palaces, it never match, because this is something worldly. Even if you increase it 10,000 million times more, it would not match something which is heavenly. So, O my angels in heaven, make for him, means make in heaven for him, for every letter that he has taught, 1,000 in thousand, means 1,000,000 palas. وَضُمُّ إِلَيْهَا مَا يَلِيقُ بِهَا مِنْ سَائِرَ النَّعَمِ And add to this whatever is suitable for this palaces. Furnish them. And perhaps not only furnish them with furniture, but also with people. Because if you have so many palaces, you need people, not only who help you, but also you love to have the best of the guests, the best of the programs to entertain them. So give them anything that suits ha. يَلِيقُ بِهَا means يَلِيقُ بِهَذِهِ الْقُسُورِ or يَلِيقُ بِالْجَنَانِ This ha should refer to something which is female, you know, pronoun. So either something that is suitable for these palaces or something which is suitable for heaven. The last hadith for today, which is very famous hadith, and I have mentioned this in some of my lectures, is قال علي بن الحسين عليه السلام Imam Zain al-Abidin عليه السلام said أوحى الله عز وجل إلى موسى عليه السلام Allah revealed to Musa عليه السلام You know, Allah spoke to Musa. He was Kalimullah. And it's not only in Torah. Allah had different conversations with Musa as he may have with other prophets, you know, because we have Hadith Qudsi, which is different from scripture, from like Quran or Torah or Injil. So Allah told Musa, Allah Nabi Nawali Walayhi Salam, حببني إلى خلقي وحبب خلقي إلي. أو موسى, أو موسى, make me lovable to my people and make them lovable to me. So bring love of my servants to me means that make them lovable. Because it's not that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala needs introduction. You know, sometimes people don't love each other because they don't know each other. You need to introduce, you need to negotiate, you need to, you know, reconcile. But when he says make them qualified to receive my love, means make them lovable, make them, you know, have qualities that I love. And make me lovable to them. Of course, Allah is good. They just need to know him. So for Allah to love us, we need to improve. For us to love Allah, again, we need to improve our understanding. Because he's perfect. He is perfect. He doesn't need to change. We have to improve our understanding of him, and we have to improve our being so that we match his expectations and we would be loved by him. So Allah said, حَبَّبْنِي إِلَىٰ خَلْقِي, make me lovable to them, make them love me, وَحَبِّبْ خَلْقِي إِلَيَّ, and make them lovable to me. قَالَ يَا رَبِّ كَيْفَ أَفْعَلْ, Moses said, oh my Lord, how I do it? Means how can I do it? قَالَ ذَكِّرْهُمْ آلَائِي وَنَعْمَائِي لَيُحَبُّونِي, remind them of my blessings and bounties so that they love me. فَلَئِنْ تَرُدَّ, then this addition is also very important. So first, because Allah has already done lots of things to us, we just need to improve our understanding. Remind them of my bounties and blessings. This is very important. Inshallah, if I get chance, maybe next week I reflect more on the hadith because there are so many important things here. Then Allah says, فَلَئِنْ تَرُدَّ عَابِقًا أَنْ بَابِي, if you manage to Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Assalamu alaikum. I had to switch off. I had to switch off because I could not hear you, and I understand many people have not been able to hear you for some time now.
Okay. Where did you stop hearing?
Started talking about Prophet Musa alayhi salam, and how he was Kalimullah. So it was quite a while back that we've not been able to.
Okay, I repeat. So this is a very well known hadith. We have it in many books, and this is a conversation between Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Musa, not in the form of Torah necessarily, it's a hadith Qudsi. And Allah said to Musa alayhi salam, حَبِّبْنِي إِلَىٰ خَلْقِي وَحَبِّبْ خَلْقِي إِلَيْهِ, make me loved by my people, lovable. Of course, Allah is lovable, but means introduce me to them, let them appreciate what I have to give them, what I have offered them, what, you know, qualities I have. In the case of us loving Allah, we don't need to change Allah. We need to improve ourselves. We need to understand our ma'rifah, our gratitude. Then, وَحَبِّبْ خَلْقِ إِلَّهِ, make my people lovable to me. Here is opposite. When we are to be lovable to Allah, we have to change. Allah is going to be lovable to us if we change, and we will be lovable to him again if we change, because he's already perfect. If we become better people, he loves us more. And if we increase in our understanding, we love him more. So this is the beauty of this hadith. حَبَّبْنِي إِلَىٰ خَلْقِي وَحَبَّبْ خَلْقِي إِلَىٰي. قَالَ يَا رَبِّ كَيْفَ أَفْعَلْ, he said, oh my Lord, how can I do this? How can I bring your love to people and make them lovable to you. قال ذكرهم آلائي والنعمائي ليحبوني. Remind them of my blessings and bounties so that they love me. If they remember what I have done for them, what I have given them, if they appreciate and acknowledge all the blessings that they have received from me, definitely they will love me. Because human beings, even if someone does one good thing to them, they remember, they appreciate. And if someone keeps doing good to them, they love him. And if we just imagine how much Allah has given us, actually Allah has given us to ourselves, Allah has created us more than giving something to someone. He has given us ourselves, He has given us our identity, our being. Definitely we are going to love Him. ذَكَّرْهُمْ أَلَاءِ وَنَعْمَائِ لَيُحَبُّونِي فَلَإِنْ تَرُدَّهُ عَابِقًا عَنْ بَابِي أَوْ ضَالًا عَنْ فَنَائِي. فَنَائِي, as we have in Salam of Imam Hussein, حَلَّتْ بِفَنَائِك, is the entrance of the door, you know, when you put your foot, you know, that footstep, you know, there, or footpath, that is fana. So Allah said, if you bring back a person who has escaped, you know, imagine your child if runs away from home, or if you have a servant who runs away, or someone who has been misguided. So either he has run away from door, or don't know how to come back, has gone out to buy something, for example, but has lost the home. Wall. He doesn't want, you know, it's different from the one who runs away. He didn't want to go away, but he has lost the address, he has lost the home. If you bring one person who has run away, or one person who has been misguided, أَفْضَلُ لَكَ مِنْ عِبَادَةِ مِئَةِ سَنَةٍ, it's better than you from worship of 100 years. But what type of years? Normal years that we fast 1 month? No. مِئَةِ سَنَةٍ صيام نهارها أو بصيام نهارها وقيام ليلها. There are two versions of this hadith. 100 years with fasting every day and doing tahajjud every night. All the night you do tahajjud and all the day you do fasting. Still, the reward for bringing one person back to religion, one person back to Allah, is more than worshipping 100 years with such quality. Then Musa alayhi salam asked, وَمَنْ هَذَا الْعَبْدُ الْعَابِقُ مِنْكُ, who is this person who has run away, who has escaped? قَالَ الْعَاصِي الْمُتَمَرِّدِ, the one who disobeyed and is rebellious. Disobedient and rebellious. He has rebelled against my will. Then he said, فَمَنْ ضَالُ عَنْ فِنَائِكَ, who is the one who has been misguided, who has gone astray, cannot find the place? قَالَ الْجَاهِلُ بِإِمَامِ زَمَانِهِ, the one who doesn't know Imam of his age. تُعَرَّفُهُ الْغَائِبَ عَنْهِ بَعْدَمَا عرفه الجاهل بالشريعة دينه تعرفه شريعته وما يعبد به ربه ويتبصل به إلى مرضاته. If someone who doesn't know Imam of his time, you can introduce to him. If someone doesn't know his Sharia, you introduce, you teach him his Sharia and what by which he can serve his Lord and can reach the pleasure of his Lord. So if you bring a sinful, rebellious person, it's very good. If you bring someone who is not rebellious, who is not disobedient, but just not know, does not know, does not, you know, have guidance again, it would be great. This hadith is very important, and one of the things we understand from this hadith is our approach in teaching Islam, lecturing, preaching, talking. The same is about perhaps any religious activities. We should do things in the way that the end result would be people loving Allah more and people becoming more lovable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yes, can you hear me?
Okay.
Yes, we can hear you.
Okay, thank you. So, we should use this approach. I think this is a good guideline. If I give a lecture, if I write a book, if I am a teacher, I run classes, if I speak with my own children, I should have always two aims in my mind. And I have to check everything according to these two indicators. Is this going to lead to people loving Allah more, or I am going to do something which makes them frightened or makes them disconnected or would not help them? It's not no impact on their relation with Allah. You have to always check these things. If you are sure that it's going to make Allah more loved by them, the relation with Allah improves. This is one indicator which is good. The other is that this should make them more lovable to Allah by helping them improve and become better people. If they become better people, Allah will love them more. So anything that we do should add to the love of people for Allah and add to their commitment to improve. Otherwise, we shouldn't do anything. This is my understanding. You can think about it, and if you disagree, you know, we can talk about it. But I think anything that we do should make people at least one step or few steps nearer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that is by adding to the love for Allah and making them better people so that they are more loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not just a matter of just doing something more. No, they should become more lovable. And if you are more lovable by Allah, you are more lovable by mu'mineen. You are more lovable by people. But of course, Allah has all the knowledge. Maybe people don't know some of your good qualities. He knows everything. But at least people who know you should feel that you are becoming better. You become a better person. Okay, I stop here and inshallah we continue the next session. Wa akhiru da'wana and alhamdulillah rabbil alameen.